Next question is question number 62. In this question, it is given that in a GSM system, 8 channels can coexist in 200 kilohertz bandwidth using TDMA. A GSM-based cellular operator is allocated 5 megahertz bandwidth, assuming a frequency reuse factor of 1 by 5, that is a 5 cell repeated pattern. The maximum number of simultaneous channel that can exist in one cell is, you have to see among the option which one is correct. So what will be the total available window of 200 kilohertz chunk for the operator, because total bandwidth is 5 megahertz allocated to the operator. So we will divide 5 megahertz with 200 kilohertz to get the number of window that is available with the operator. So the total number of available window is nothing but 25. So 25 number of windows available for the operator, each of 200 kilohertz bandwidth. Now coming to the cellular pattern. If all the 25 window is used in single cell, then for adjacent cell there will be inter-channelic interference, because the same set of frequency will be used here also. That will create inter-channelic interference, hence it will disturb the communication process. So that's why the frequency reuse factor is used to avoid the inter-channelic interference. So the cellular pattern will be looking like this, that is there will be 5 cell and the 25 windows that will be divided equally across all these 5 cells, and after the 5 cells the frequency will be reused. So if you see, the same set of frequency used here will be used here. So the frequency used by the cells are at distance place, hence inter-channelic interference is avoided. As the 25 windows available with the operator will be divided equally across the 5 cells, so per cell available window we can easily get, the power cell window is nothing but 25 into the frequency reuse factor, that is 1 by 5, that will give us 5 windows. So power cell we have only 5 windows available, and each window will have 200 kilohertz bandwidth. In the question it is given that 8 channel can coexist in 200 kilohertz bandwidth using TDMA system. So what will be the number of channel per cell? So the total number of channel per cell will be simply this 5 will multiply 8 channel that is coexist in a single cell. So that will be 40 channels per cell. And in the question it is asked the maximum number of simultaneous channel that can exist in one cell, that we have to find out. So among the option, if we see, option B is matching with our result. Hence option B is the correct answer for question number 62. Next question is question number 63. In this question, in a direct sequence CDMA system, the chip rate is given as 1.2288 into 10 to the power 6 chips per second. If the process gain is desired to be at least 100, the data rate we have to find out among the options which one is matching. What we know is process gain is equal to chip rate by data rate. Okay. So data rate we can easily get simply equal to chip rate divided by process gain. Here the process gain is desired to be at least 100, so the process gain is at minimum. So for minimum value of process gain, as the process gain is in the denominator, so for minimum value of process gain the data rate will be maximum. In the question, the minimum process gain is given to be at least 100, so if we substitute here 100 and chip rate is given, then we will get the maximum data rate to be equal to 12.288 into 10 to the power 3 bits per second. So that is the maximum data rate. So the data rate must not exceed this value. Otherwise we can say the data rate should be less than or equal to this value. Less than equal to this value. So if we see among the option, it must be less than or equal to 12.288 into 10 to the power 3. Other option, if you see in the B, it is given greater than this value, so this is not correct. Must be exactly equal, this is also not correct. Can't take any value, so this is also not correct. So option A is showing that the data rate must be less than or equal to the maximum value, that is 12.288 into 10 to the power 3 bits per second. So A is the correct answer for question number 63. Hence A is the correct answer for question number 63. Next question, 74 and 75 both are linked questions and they are having common data. It is given that 2-4 array signal constellations are shown. It is given that 5-1 and 5-2 constitute an orthonormal basis for the two constellations. Assume that the four symbols in both the constellations are equiprobable. Let N0 by 2 denote the power spectral density of white Gaussian noise. Then in the question number 74, it is asked the ratio of the average energy of the constellation 1 to the average energy of the constellation 2 is, that is energy ratio of constellation 1 divided by constellation 2, we have to find out. And the 75 question is, if these constellations are used for digital communication over an AWGN channel, then which one of the following statements is true? We have to find out. That is, we have to conclude about the probability of symbol error in both the cases. First, let us find out the solution for question number 74, that is the signal energy ratio of constellation 1 to constellation 2, we have to find out. The average symbol energy for a constellation diagram is given by this generalized expression, that is summation of em, where m is from 0 to m and that is averaged over 1 by m. So that is the signal energy for a constellation diagram, where em is the energy of the signal points. And what is em? Em is nothing but square of the distance from the origin of that signal point. That is DOM is given by distance of mth point from the origin. So let's calculate the energy for the first constellation diagram. For first constellation diagram, if you see, there are four signal points. Okay, this point is already at distance 0. We have to find out this distance, this distance, this distance. Then we can find out what is the average energy. So, as I said, this point is already at the origin, so the distance is 0. If we see, this is 2 root 2, so half of this is root 2a. This is given root 2a, so root 2a, this distance will be only 2a. Okay, this distance will be only 2a, similarly this distance will be also 2a. So that is 2a square for this signal point, for this signal point is also 2a square. And for this signal point, the distance is already 2 root 2a, so 2 root 2a whole square. So if we solve this, we will get the average energy for constellation 1. So what is the average energy for constellation 1? That is coming out to be 4a square. Next, let us calculate the average signal energy for constellation 2. For constellation 2, if we see all the signal points, all the constellation points are at equal distance from the origin, that is the distance is a. Okay, a. So the average energy is given by simply a square into 4 times, and that will be average over 1 by 4. So that will be a square. So the average energy for constellation 2 is a square. Now the ratio ES1 by ES2 will be equal to 4. So in the question it is asked the ratio of the average energy of constellation 1 to the average energy of constellation 2. Hence 4 is the correct answer for question number 74. Next part of the question, that is 75 is about the probability of symbol error of both the constellation. Now let us discuss the basic difference between two different constellation. In the first one, the signal points are at larger distance. In the second point, the signal constellations are at smaller distance comparison to the first one. So during the decision making, we have a larger cushion to find out the correct signal point when the distance is large, whereas when the distance is small, the cushion is very small, so the probability error will be more. Otherwise, you can say if the distance is more, the probability of error is less. So in these two diagram, the probability of error will be less obviously in the first case because the distance is more. Or in otherwise, we have a Q function. The probability of error is always related to the Q function, which is given by Q of square root of d square by 2 n naught, where n naught by 2 is already given the power spectral density. And if we plot distance in x axis and probability of error in y axis, then it will be a waterfall curve. That is, with the increase in distance, the probability of error will be reduced. So we can say probability of error is inversely related to distance. Now let us focus on the constellations that are given in the questions. We have to find out the distance between constellation point in both the cases to find out the probability of error. In the first case, the distance is simply 2a, because we have already found out 2a, 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 2a. So each signal point are having at equal distance, that is 2a. So the minimum distance in constellation 1 is at 2a. Similarly, let us find out the constellation 2 case. In constellation 2 case, this is already a, this is a, so this distance is root 2a. So we have the minimum distance root 2a between constellation points. Clearly, d1 is greater than d2, so the probability of error will be less in case of constellation 1 than constellation 2. So as d1 is greater than d2, the probability of error is less in case of constellation 1 than constellation 2. If we see among the option, in option A, probability of symbol error for constellation 1 is lower. So A is the correct answer for question number 75. Next questions are 82 and 83. These two are linked questions and they are having common data. It is given that an input to a 6 level quantizer has the probability density function fx as shown in the figure. Fx is shown here. Decision boundary of the quantizer are chosen so as to maximize the entropy of the quantizer output. It is given that three consecutive decision boundaries are minus 1, 0 and 1. So minus 1, 0 and 1, these are the three consecutive decision boundaries are given. There are 6 levels for the quantizer. First question, we have to find out the value of A and B, that is, what is this value of A and what is this value of B. Then we have to find out, assume that the reconstruction level of the quantizer are the midpoint of the decision boundary, the ratio of the signal power to quantization noise power we have to find out. So what is given? It is given that there are 6 quantization level and the entropy should be maximized, so the probability for each quantizer level should be equal. For maximum entropy, each quantization level area must be equal. As there are 6 quantizer level, so area under each level will be 1/6. Next, in the question it is given 3 consecutive decision boundary are at minus 1, 0 and 1. So minus 1, 0 and 1, 3 consecutive decision boundaries are given. We will find out the other boundaries later. First, let us concentrate on question number 82, that is, we have to find out the value of A and B. If you see, as the quantization level are minus 1, 0 and 1, so this area is 1/6 of the area, because each area of the quantization level should be equal, that is 1/6. So if this area is 1/6, that means this is nothing but a rectangle. So the area of the rectangle is nothing but, this is 1 unit and this is height is A. So the area is simply A. So you can say 1 into A is equal to 1/6. So A equal to 1/6. So we have found out what is the value of A. Now, as this is the probability density function, so the area, total area under the curve should be equal to 1. So what is the total area? Total area is nothing but, this is 2 unit and height is A. So this area will be 2 into A, and this area will be simply replication of the same this area. So this area is nothing but, the length is of 4 unit and the height is B. So 4 into B, that will be 2 times, because the same area is also present here. So the total area is nothing but 2A, that is, 2 is the base and height is A. So 2A for this rectangle, and for this rectangle it is 4 into B and 2 times, because The same area is also present here. So 2 times into 4b. This is the total area, and the total area should be equal to 1, because the probability density integration or the area under the probability density function should be equal to 1. We have already found out the a value as 1/6. So if we substitute the a value here, then we can easily get what is the value of b, that is equal to 1/12. So if we see among the option A is matching, that is A equal to 1/6 and B equal to 1/12. So A is the correct answer for question number 82. Next part is 83. In this we have to find out the ratio between signal power to the quantization noise power. So in the question it is given that 3 consecutive decision boundary, that is -1, 0, 1. Let us find out the other decision boundary. Let us concentrate about this area. This area is nothing but 4 into B, okay. So 4 into B is equal to 4 into 1/12, because B is 1/12. So that is equal to 1/3. We can write 1/3 as 2/6. We have already found out area of each quantization level is 1/6. So this area is 2/6. That means 2 times area is present here. So exactly at the midpoint, there will be one decision boundary, so that area will be divided equally. As this is equal to 4 units, so what will be the midpoint? Midpoint will be 2 units will be added to 1, that is equal to 3. Midpoint will be at 3. So we have another decision boundary at 3. Similarly, in the negative side also, we will have another decision boundary at -3. So -3, so another decision boundary will be at -3. So we have successfully found out all the decision boundary. Hence we have the 6 quantization level, that is this one, that is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. 6 quantization level we have found out, but the quantization level step size is not uniform here. So this is basically a non-uniform quantization, because here it is 2 unit, here it is 2 unit, but here it is only 1 unit, here it is only 1 unit, here it is 2 unit, here it is 2 unit. First, let us find out what is the signal power. The signal power is nothing but integration over -infinity to infinity x square fx dx. Fx is the probability density function. So this is basically an even function. So we can simply write 2 times 0 to infinity x square fx dx. So 0 to infinity means 0 to 1 will have one part, 0 to 1 will have x square, and the value is simply a dx, and from 1 to 5 the value will be simply b. So x square b dx. After integration of the first part, that is x square a value, if you see a value is already 1/6, and x square integration will be x cube by 3. So the first part will be 2, a is 1/6, and the integration of x square over 0 to 1 will be 1/3. Similarly, coming to the second part b will be 1/12. So 2 into 1/12 will be there, and this will be x cube by 3, and 1 and 5 will be substituted. So accordingly, we will get this value. Further simplification, the signal power is coming out to be 7 watt. Now, the quantization noise power we have to find out. As I have already said, there are 6 quantization level. For maximum entropy, each quantization level area must be equal. So area under each level is 1/6. The quantization noise power for non-uniform quantization is given by this expression, where delta 1, delta 2 are signifying the step size, the different step size, or you can say del I is the step size. So what are the delta, that is the step size present here? Here 1 is 2 unit. This is 2 unit, this is 2 unit, this is only single unit, this is also single unit, this is 2 unit, this is 2 unit. So we have delta 1, we can say delta 1 is of length 2, and delta 2, that is between 0 to 1 and 0 to minus 1, this length is of unit 1. So if we calculate the noise power for delta 1, that is this delta 1, this is 2 unit. How many 2 units are there? This is 1, 2, 3, 4. So 4 units are there. So we will multiply 4 delta 1 square divided by 12. Coming to the second part, delta 2, only 2 units are there, here and here. So delta 2 square divided by 12 into 2. What is delta 1 and delta 2? Delta 1 is simply 2, because delta 1 is simply 2 and delta 2 is 1. So the noise power, if we substitute these things here, then we will get the noise power to be 1 by 6 into, this is 2 square, that is 4 into 4 divided by 12, plus this is 1 square, that is 1 into 2 divided by 12. After solving this, we will get the noise power to be 1 by 4 watt. So quantization noise power, we got 1 by 4 watt. Signal power, we have already found out 7 watt. Noise power, that is the quantization noise power, is 1 by 4 watt. So the signal to noise power is equal to 7 by 1 by 4, that is equal to 28. So signal to noise power is simply 28. If we see among the option, option D is matching with our result. So D is the correct answer. This concludes solutions with concepts of all the questions of GATE 2007 in respect of communication subject. If you like, you may subscribe to my channel, Helping Hand for EC Students, to stay updated with latest videos showing concepts wise detailed solutions of previous year questions, which will be based on subject wise. If you have any query, you can always drop your comments in the comment section. I will address your query. Thank you.